what you mean to me. Here in my heart, I believe your love is all I'll ever need. Holding you close through the night, I need.
Good morning, Christ community. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Brian Curley, and on behalf of our pastor, Dr. Terrence Autry, we want to welcome you to our Sunday virtual service. Christ community, you know how we flow. If you would, in the chat feed, if you would just welcome someone you know, welcome someone you don't know, and just spread the love of Christ. Come on, right now, just say hello, hello, good morning, and just welcome those, whether you're on Facebook or on YouTube. At Christ Community, we exist to make followers of Jesus who experience life change and make a difference. And we have multiple ways that you can stay connected during this time. The first way you can stay connected is by liking us on Facebook. And the second way you can stay connected is by subscribing to our YouTube channel. And the third way is to stay tuned to our websites for any events that we have going on.
Hello, Christ community. I hope you're doing well, but I felt a need to come and just share a few thoughts regarding the recent and horrific tragedy that we've seen in the shooting of Jacob Blake. Definitely want to give a shout out to all the ministers that allowed God to use them so powerfully in my absence during the month of August. Tanya Neal, Larry Walker, Travis Taylor, Jada Jackson, and surely we got another great word coming today from Doug Smiley. I am so proud of each and every one of them and how they have lent themselves to the Lord, and the power of the Spirit has just used them to touch our lives and change us forever. But again, I had to say something. Another tragic shooting. The list grows. 7 times shot in the back. Jacob Blake. Nothing changes. And if you're wondering, you're probably wondering, well, number one, what is God up to? But then number two, what does this say to us about being followers of Jesus? Probably what has really broken my heart is how the nation has been quickly to criminalize this man. There's a virulent Christian nationalism in our midst that would suggest that somehow our allegiance ought to be to the flag rather than to the cross. And Mr. Pence, if I can say a word to you, George Washington is not the writer of the book of Hebrews. And old glory that you replaced Jesus with is a flag. Our allegiance is to Christ. Doesn't mean we love our country any less, but we surely love our Christ much more. And we've got to be careful of this COVID Christianity that has infected our churches and this nation, that would suggest to you and I that we're not to have compassion, we're not to have empathy for those who are marginalized. But again, the question still remains, what is God calling us to do? And I believe he's calling us to make a difference, as always. I don't think these events are accidents. I surely don't believe God intends to bring harm, but at the same time, God allows it, or even causes it, some may say, to bring it to our attention, to see what kind of faith do we have. Do we have a sideline faith? Do we have a faith that simply is concerned about the right answers rather than the right response? And I believe Christ community is more of the latter, that we have to respond to these events. And so first and foremost, we got to remember we're in a fight. Frederick Douglass said it so well, there's no progress without a struggle. We've been fighting since the day we set foot on this country, whether it's the Revolutionary War, the Civil War, whether it's civil rights, whether it's Jim Crow, segregation, World War I, World War II, and even today in the marches that marches against racism and injustice. It's a fight, and we're gonna always be in a fight. But I wanna encourage you, if God gave us the fight, it must mean that we can get the victory. So I wanna encourage you to be a part of the fight. Number two, I also want to encourage the young people that have taken the fight to the streets and will not be quiet on this issue. I'm so impressed with this marvelous protest that has engulfed the nation and the world. And you are carrying the legacy. And yes, you're going to have the haters. You're going to have the opposition. And they're going to come up with all kind of litmus test ideas as to why you ought not support it. But you know in your heart of hearts what God is moving you to do. And so I want to encourage our young people. I'm even proud of my NBA as they cancel games this week because justice is more important. Took my admiration level to another level, and I'm proud of them. Proud of Doc Rivers to be able to step up and say what he said. That's what God, I believe, looks for us in this in these moments. We have to continue to fight. And so more than ever, y'all, we got to be a part of the protests. But more importantly, we got to vote. We got to vote. And you're going to hear more from Cam Scott in the outreach ministry in terms of the different process to make sure we're registered to vote and how we will vote together. I want to encourage you that if you're not registered, get registered ASAP. If you are registered, make sure your family, your friends, your neighbors, your coworkers, fight the good fight and make sure they are registered to vote as well. Parents, if you have teenagers in your house, 18 and over, make sure they're registered to vote and explain to them why this election is critical. And more importantly, y'all, we can't just vote on the national level. We got to get involved at the state level and the local level as well. As much as we need to change the national level, you know we've had our challenges here at the state and local level here in the state of Texas. We've got to hold these elected officials accountable, but more importantly, we've got to make sure that the elected officials that represent us represent our interests. We've got to put the ones in office that represent us. It's got to be a change in us as well, not just the society. So just want to encourage you, keep the fight, keep the faith. Let's trust God in these times to know that He's given us the baton because we know what to do with it. We know how to run well, and we also know how to pass it on to the next generation. I'll close with this. I heard an announcer talk about LeBron James and how he's a tremendous athlete, but also a tremendous humanitarian in person. And that's because he has an on-the-court game and an off-the-court game. His on-the-court game is well-known. I mean, he's an assist maker. He knows how to involve all his players and his teammates. He's a coach. He's a mentor on the floor. He can defend. He can score. He can set players up. He's a leader. He has a great on-the-court game, which makes him one of the greatest players of all time. But more recently, we've seen his off-the-court game and how he's been committed to education, how he's been committed to social justice, how he's been committed to speak out and make sure the message is out, how he's been committed to voter registration and many other aspects, even to the detriment of his own economic success, because he has both an on-the-court and off-the-court game. And if the truth be told, that's what it means to be a follower of Jesus. We ought to have an on-the-court and an off-the-court game. Our on-the-court game is when we come together to worship. Our on-the-court game is when we get a word. Our on-the-court game is when we're in Bible study and discipleship. Our on-the-court game is when we do fellowship and do ministry. Those are wonderful on-the-court games. But there comes a point, if the Spirit of God indwells us, He wants us to have an off-the-court game too. We've got to engage the community. We've got to deal with the issues that plague the community. We've got to deal with issues of justice and injustice. We've got to deal with police brutality. We've got to deal with all these issues because they involve our off-the-court game as well. Don't be a Christian that only has an on-the-court game. Make sure your off-the-court game speaks louder than your on-the-court game. And I know that's the kind of church you are. God bless you. Proud of you. Let's hear this great word from Doug Smiley, and I'll definitely see you next week. Love you. Talk to you soon.
It is now time for the offering. We want to thank you for your gifts. During this COVID season, we've been able to serve our community, and your gifts have allowed us to do that and so much more. We ask that you would continue giving, and we have a number of ways in which you can give. The ways you can give are now shown on the screen. You can text to give, as well as you can send a check in the mail. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you, God, for the gifts that you are using to impact and bless your community. Lord, we ask that you would multiply these gifts. We give them to you. We thank you, God, for being such a great provider. In the name of Jesus, amen. All right, now I got to get out the way, and we got to worship and praise God, but I want to encourage you that while you're at home right now, that you would just dig a little deeper in your worship time. God desires to connect with us, and so if you would right now just connect with Him in this time of worship, go deeper in the Word, and we'll see you soon.
Lord, we come to you in worship, not just for what you've done for us, Lord, because you've done so much and you deserve worship for that. But Lord, we worship you for who you are, because you're holy, you're good, you're loving, you're graceful. Lord, we just come to worship you today. My worship, all of my worship. Receive my worship. All of my worship.
Yes, God.
Here's my worship. All of my worship. Receive my worship. All of my worship.
You, Lord, you are worthy.
And no one can worship you
for me.
For all the things
you've done for me.
And I'll let no one.
Worship you for me.
You, Lord,
you are worthy. And no one can worship you for me.
As long as I am breathing,
I will, Lord.
yes, God. Here is our worship. We're giving it to you right now, God. You've been so gracious, God. With everything we're going through, God, you have shown yourself to be real. Regardless of COVID-19, God, you are still sovereign. You are still God. We're trusting you. We're trusting you. We're loving you, God. We owe you our worship. You've been so good. You've been so good, God. We love you, Jesus. Is my worship, all of my worship, receive my worship, all of my worship. Sing, y'all.
Is my worship,
all
of my worship,
receive my
worship.
All
of my worship.
Here it is.
Is my worship.
All of my
worship.
Receive my worship.
Worship. All of my worship.
Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. Oh, you, God. Here's our worship. Receive it, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you, God.
Most gracious and heavenly Father, how we thank you for this moment. We thank you for this time. And God, we praise you right now in this right now moment and in this space. God, I would ask that you would move and touch people right where they are. God, I would ask that you would provide insight, guide us and take us on a journey that reveals who you are and the calling that you have on our individual lives. God, I pray for everyone that's under the sound of my voice. I would ask that you would hide me behind the cross, that we may know you in a more intimate fashion as we dive into your word on this morning. We ask it all in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Christ community, this morning, I believe that God has an extremely encouraging word. And, you know, there's so much good stuff and so much meat and potatoes within this thing. It is just tasty to my soul. And so I can't wait to dive in. And so let's do that right now. Let's go right into the scriptures and see what God has to say for us. So today we want to look at Job, the first chapter, the first through the 20th verse. And I know that's a lot of verses, but man, when you dive into scripture and you really start reading, I mean, I know some of you have probably binge watched Netflix, but man, if you just read the scriptures, the stories and what happens in scripture is so revealing. So let's see what happens to Job in the first chapter, the first through the 20th verse. And it reads as this. In the land of Uz, there lived a man whose name was Job. This man was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil. He had 7 sons, 3 daughters. He owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke and oxen, and 500 donkeys. And he had a large number of servants. He was the greatest man among all of the people of the East. His sons used to hold feasts in their homes on their birthdays, and they would invite the 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. When a period of feasting had run its course, Job would make arrangements for them to be purified. In the morning, he would sacrifice a burnt offering for each of them, thinking, "Perhaps my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts." This was Job's regular custom. One day, the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, from roaming throughout the earth, going back and forth. And we all know what Satan is here to do, right? Say it with me. He came to kill, steal, kill, and destroy. No different. Then the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil. Does Job fear God for nothing? Satan replied. Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? You have blessed the work of his hands so that his flocks and his herds are spread throughout the land. But now stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face. The Lord said to Satan, very well then, everything he has is in your power. But on the man himself, do not lay a finger. Then Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. I want everybody to repeat right here. It's about to go down. Watch this, verse 13. One day when Job's sons and daughters were feasting and drinking wine at the oldest brother's house, a messenger came to Job and said, the oxen were plowing and the donkeys were grazing nearby. The Sabians attacked and made off with them. They put the servants to the sword, and I am the only one to escape to tell you. While he was still speaking, another messenger came and said, the fire of God fell from the heavens and burned up the sheep and the servants. I am the only one who has escaped to tell you. While he was still speaking, another messenger came and said, the Chaldeans formed three raiding parties and swept down on your camels and made off with them. They put the servants to the sword, and I am the only one who has escaped to tell you. And again, while he was speaking, yet another servant came and said, your sons and your daughters were feasting and drinking wine at the oldest brother's house when suddenly a mighty wind swept from the desert and struck the four corners of the house. It collapsed on them, and they are all dead. I am the only one who has escaped to tell you. And at this, Job got up, tore off his robe, shaved his head, then fell to the ground in worship. As we look to jump into this text and figure out, you know, what it is that God is trying to say to us, I'd like to tag this text with the title, When It Rains, It Pours. I believe all of us that have lived any length of time, if we have ever been privy to see the sun rise and set at the end of a day, we will all come to a point in life where it seems like, or at least feels like, everything around us is crumbling. Surely that's what Job must have felt in our text. He is losing everything. And before he can get the news of one situation, here comes news of another horrible situation. I believe Job would say, when it rains, it pours. And many of us can attest to that very same thing. For example, it may seem like once you get one child seemingly going in the right direction, that's when child number two says it's on and popping and it's time for them to turn all the way up. Or maybe your situation is while you are grieving the loss of a loved one, before you can process all of that, here comes the phone call saying that another loved one is either sick and or worse yet has passed on. Maybe your situation of feeling like it when it rains, it pours is you have applied and went on job interview after job interview. Every one of them seems to have gone very, very well, yet you find yourself in those moments receiving email after email and phone call after phone call saying thanks, but no thanks. Maybe your situation is before you can finish licking the wounds after having been in one bad relationship, you find yourself in another bad relationship experiencing the same kind of mess. And the only thing different about it is the face that's attached to it. Or maybe you wake up in a country where less than 30 days ago you find yourself dealing with the social injustice of African-American males in particular, unarmed, being murdered. And before you can wrap your brain around that, what it means, why it's happening, you come home to find on the news yet a similar situation. You can feel like when it rains, it pours. And all I'm simply trying to say to you this morning is that we've all had those feelings of a barrage of what seems to be bad luck. Matter of fact, sometimes we'll say to ourselves, it seems like soon as I take one step forward, something knocks me two steps back. See, it's really easy to praise and to worship God when everything is going right. But it surely tests our faith when it seems that the storms in our life are so continual that we find ourselves saying, when it rains, it pours. The exciting thing and the good news here is that within this text, there are some things that happen that we can look at that can give us hope for tomorrow. And Job is just a gleaming example of how we can engage and be steadfast in our faith. So the good news is this, as we look at my main man, Job, in this text, there are some awesome examples of what steadfast faith looks like. There's a couple of things in the text that intrigue me. Before I get on to those things that really, really solidify us and bring us in, there's just a couple of things that I want to point out to you. You know, number one is Job was a ball of shock. He had it all. He was balling. His paper was stacked. He would have had a house in the Hamptons. He'd have been driving a Maybach Mercedes. I mean, every luxury you could have had in life. He would have had status, right? But that doesn't mean he was exempt from adversity. And oftentimes we look at people through the lens of, if I only had what they had, then maybe I wouldn't have to go through the stuff that I'm going through. And that's just simply not the case. Nobody is exempt from going through it. It's what you do in those times that separate you. The other thing that is really intriguing here is, watch this. Verse number 8, God says to Satan, have you considered my servant? So let's back up. Here, there's a conversation going on, and Satan's roaming the earth looking for somebody. He gets to God. God says, hey, what are you doing here? And then there's this conversation where God takes the initiative and says, have you considered my servant, my servant Job, rather? And the reason why that's so intriguing is because of the ownership of the possessive, my servant. It is both possessive and relational. And here's what I mean by that. This is amazing. This really shows the love of God. Here it is. So when God says, have you considered my servant? It's because of the relationship and what has transpired between God and Job prior to these events. God recognizes that Job praises and worships him routinely. He's established something that God now takes ownership of, right? And it all has to do with the relationship that the two have. Let me explain it a different way. So in high school, well, at least for me, I don't know how it is for you, but in high school, you know, you would have a little boyfriend, girlfriend situation or entanglement, right? Whenever that happened for you. And in my school, we would ask people, hey, are you claiming them or are you claiming her, right? Because it was one thing to say we were boyfriend and girlfriend, but if the other person didn't claim you, then it wasn't what it was, right? And so here is something that's going on. When God says, have you considered my servant, Job? It's claiming the relationship that that I belong to you and you belong to me. And that's just a beautiful thing. I mean, how great and wonderful it is for you to be in a relationship with a God who claims you, a God who says, when I saved you, I didn't get buyer's remorse. It doesn't matter what you have done. Bible says nothing can separate us from the love of God. When he claimed you, when he saved you, he owned it. And that's just a beautiful thing. So those two things right there really, really jump out. And I just think that they're fascinating. But that brings you to a point where you get on your high horse and you just say, man, that's wonderful. There's some ownership, right? God loves me because of my relationship, because of how we relate to one another. There's an ownership piece that connects us. So you're left to ask the question, why does bad things happen to good people? I mean, the scripture says that Job was blameless and he hadn't done anything wrong. He actually was walking the straight and narrow, something that we've all tried to be. Because I bet you many of you are sitting right now watching saying, you know, I got some stuff in my closet that I'm not necessarily proud of. And maybe God, the things that are happening to me are because God is somehow upset with me or God doesn't love me anymore. Or God doesn't like me, right? Listen, he's not surprised. He doesn't operate in like anyway. All he does is love you. I submit this thought to you about faith. Faith is not a path that we follow. It's just a step that we take. So there's your hashtag moment. Faith is not a path that we follow. It's just a step that we take. You ever see those maps in the mall where you are here and you're trying to find the store that you want to go to, and it has a path that you can follow to get to that store? And the reason why it's a path is because it shows you every turn, nook and cranny, and what's along the way. But I submit to you this morning that our faith doesn't really work like that. It's just a step that we take. If scripture tells us that we are walking out our faith, the only way we can walk is step by step. And so God and our faith is only the next step. And it's trusting that beyond every step that I take, I'm going to get closer and closer and closer to the thing that God has for me. But I'm believing God on the next step. And that's a place that we all got to get to. So when it's pouring down in your life and it's raining heavy and you get to that point where you feel like when it rains, it pours, Job highlights three things for us that we need to remember in those times. Number one, the suffering is seasonal. Now, when we look at the text, all of the suffering that Job goes through actually comes to an end where somebody else doesn't come to the house and give him more bad news. God even limits Satan and says, you can have everything and control and power over everything. Just don't touch his life. That confirms it's either God allowed or God ordained. God had to remove the hedge of protection, but he still had control and said, listen, you can do everything. Just don't touch his life. The suffering is seasonal, although it may go, it may be very, very tough for you to swallow, very, very tough for you to deal with. The truth of the matter is it's seasonal. It comes to an end. I tell you what, in high school, I'm going back to high school again. I had some great memories in high school. In high school, pre-calculus, I'm really, really good in math and I'm really, really good in English. And when they gave me a course and they put letters and numbers together, I was like, the devil is a lie. I'm not going to be able to do this. And my first year in pre-cal was just horrible. The only thing that got me through was I knew if I could show up every day and they didn't kick me out for getting low scores on tests, that class was only going to be one semester. And that's all I'm submitting to you today is you've got to understand that the season of struggle that you're going through isn't going to last always. I think, you know, we get so confused by what we want to label as cliche Christianity because of the redundancy that we hear these phrases repeated. We don't stop to really take notion of the power that they really have. For example, you may have heard people say, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. That's a powerful statement. It proclaims that your suffering is seasonal. You may hear folks say, trouble don't last always. Although that's simple when we've heard it, it's still powerful because it proclaims that your suffering is seasonal. Scripture tells us that knowing all things that we are more than conquerors. It proclaims that victory is ours. Doesn't mean we won't have a fight. It just means that in the fight, we're going to be victorious. And then, you know, you have phrases or scriptures that tell you that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings as eagles. Those are victorious statements that let us know and remind us that the suffering is seasonal. The second thing that we need to be aware of when we're going through those, and we really need to be careful here, is don't lose or don't abandon your spiritual integrity. It's really easy because of something called grief. So when we look at our brother Job, what he's experiencing is a ton of loss. And so that's where the word is connected to the word grieve and grief. It has to do with the loss of something. And it's not always necessarily the loss of or in death, although that's what it's most associated with. Anytime you lose anything, there is a grieving factor to it. But the thing about grief that's so perplexing is the body doesn't recognize the emotion, if you will, of grief the same way it does love or anger or fear, because grief is kind of a gateway emotion. It psychology even says it has 7 different stages. And so when you grieve, you never know how you're gonna wake up feeling in the morning. Have you ever been in one of those places where you were grieving some and you went through a whole litany of emotions? One moment you mad, the next minute you somewhat happy, but you don't know if you're happy and going insane. Then you depressed, and grief just takes you all over the place. And so you have to be careful in those times that you don't abandon your spiritual integrity. Surely Job had every reason to feel like God is not there. He had lost everything, yet he stood firm because of his hope in who God was. Although his life had been turned upside down, he lost his wealth, his children, his health was fading. Job makes one of the most powerful statements in all of Scripture that talks about steadfastness. He says along there in Scripture, he says, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. And that's the word on this morning, is it doesn't matter what you're going through. The beauty is in the redemption power and the saving power and the grace and mercy of our God. And though he slay me, yet will I trust him. And then lastly, it's really simple. God is in control. He's still God. Job says, in all of his anguish, in all of his pain, he says, God's built up a wall. He says his family has failed him. Friends have forgotten him. He's become repulsive to his wife. And then after that, he declares, but I know that my Redeemer lives. You know, the old folks used to sing a song. Let me not call them old folks. The old saints used to sing a song. He lives. And it was their ability to know that the Christ in them lives. And because he's alive, I can have hope for tomorrow, despite what I'm going through. Understand, at the beginning when we looked at Job, God was still in control. Nothing happened until God said so. Satan said, if you remove the hedge from around him and allow me to do these things, then he will surely curse you to your face. God is still in control. And because Job had enough spiritual integrity to just take the next step and the next step. Did he have pain? Absolutely. Did he have fear? Absolutely. Did he feel like maybe God had abandoned him? Absolutely. The entire book, you see the entire gamut of his emotions as he goes through that. But he kept walking towards God. He kept moving forward. He kept worshiping. He kept praising. He kept reverencing. And as he kept on taking step by step at step, spoiler alert, we all know what happens. At the end, he's blessed to receive a double portion. Now, all of this is great. We know that the season, that our struggle is seasonal. We understand that, you know, in these tough times when it's feeling like it's just pouring down in your life, we need to keep a level of our spiritual integrity. But I think the bottom line of all of it is he's still God. Many of us can wake up in the morning and attest to being in situations where we've just experienced the goodness of God. We've just experienced his grace. I know that personally in my life, I have. And some of the things that get me through those tough times are the things that God has brought me through. A lot of times, your test and testimonies become the fabrics of new freedoms. Sometimes when you go through stuff, it gives you the strength and the ability to withstand whatever it is that's coming next. Listen, walk in the path of Christianity and walk in the life where you serve God and you serve Jesus, and it is not one where you're guaranteed not to have to go through something. It's just that when you go through it, you get to go through it with him. And it's in that relationship, it's in that possessive relational connection between you and God where you can find peace in the midst of your storm. Let us pray. God, how we thank you for this word. The truth is that we struggle sometimes because we're so connected to our things. And that when we feel like the things we have and the things we want are slipping away and slipping out of our hand, that somehow you don't love us anymore. And so, God, I ask and I would pray right now that you would touch every individual and reaffirm in them that you take ownership of the relationship between your people and yourself. God, we thank you for your saving grace. We thank you for your redeeming and redemptive power. God, we submit to you and we place it all in your hands. Our love and our desire for you and our desire to get to know you better and in more intimate fashion is not predicated on the things that we have, but it's simply because you are God and God alone. We thank you and we loved you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, there may be, you know, individuals who say, you know, I want to know what it's like to be in relationship. You know, I've had some issues and I've had some things happen in my life, and the truth of the matter is I don't really know God like that. I've not experienced the love or seen the Christ, seen the love of Christ. I haven't had that experience. And I've been to church and, you know, I know some church folks, but I want to connect. I want to be in the family. I want to get to know him. Well, the beautiful thing about it is Christ wants to meet you exactly where you are. And he wants to walk hand in hand, lock arms with you, and walk this thing called life by your side. And one of the greatest things that we can have is to, and ever experience, is to know him and to feel his presence. And so wherever you are, if that's you, if you're in a space where you're saying, you know, I want to get to know him, then God opens his doors and God stretches his hand and invites you in. And so here at Christ Community, I'll lead you in prayer. If that's you and that's where you want to be, and you want to be in relationship with Christ, I'll lead you. You follow in this prayer, and surely God will save you. And so repeat after me. Thank you, Lord, that you died for my sins. Thank you for forgiveness. I accept you as my Savior and Lord. Thank you for saving me to make a difference in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen, it's just that simple. We are so glad that you decided to hook up and link up with Christ. We always say here at Christ Community that right now, the angels in heaven are throwing a party in your name because you are now a part of the family and a part of the fold. To my Christ Community family, we thank you for watching and being a part of our worship celebration. We hope that God has spoke to you and that you have felt something that's going to make a difference in this world. From our senior pastor, Dr. Terrence Autry, and everybody here at Christ Community, we love you and we'll see you. Amen.